So the first part, the description of the problem, the impacts of climate change on resource tenure. I think each one of us knows that there's a litany of woes that the world is facing. We're very concerned about erratic rainfall, receding glaciers, melting ice caps, water shortages, population growth, biodiversity loss, coastal flooding, rising sea levels, shifting rainfall patterns. The litany of woes seems to be inordinately complex, inordinately sad. But to make the story more complicated, what are the impacts of these environmental variables on land tenure and property rights regimes? What is the story of this unfolding interface? This is a story that's complex, a story that is not yet told, and we are all on a pioneering adventure today, exploring these complex interfaces. But before we launch into this story, let's remember some key issues. First of all, we need to make sure that we define our terms very carefully. What do we mean by the impacts of climate change on property rights regimes? Remember back to the previous sessions for this course where we talked about bundles of rights to privately held land or other natural resources. We've talked about rights to publicly held land or other natural resources. Don't forget these definitions, and please be careful in the use of these terms. We're going to be looking during this session on the impacts of climate change on a bundle of rights to resources. We're going to be looking at how climate change is impacting property rights arrangements around water, browsing and grazing lands, collection of secondary tree crop products. We're going to be looking at how climate change and tenure is in fact impacting a bundle of interconnected rights for particular places around the world. So let's remember what a bundle of rights are. It's the right to use, the right to manage, the right to transfer, and the right to own natural resources. And we're looking at how tenure systems are changing in the face of climate change. So the key question today is, how are statutory tenure systems changing, and how are customary tenure systems changing? From previous readings and discussions in this course, I'm sure you have all discussed in great depth how colonial state policy around statutory tenure systems has evolved over time through the present. But similarly, customary tenure systems change, and you have discussed that as well. There has been an evolution of indigenous people's rights to natural resources. Customary systems are not static. They change, they evolve. You have also seen how there's an interface between these two tenure systems that leads to what I call a mosaic of tenure arrangements for particular places and particular times, and unique to the moment. It's this complex interface between customary and statutory that we're looking at today, and how climate change is changing very rapidly these mosaics. So how do we tackle this very difficult question? I'd like to give some advice from my learning, from my struggling of how to understand these issues. I find it very helpful to, first of all, identify the spatial location of vulnerabilities. And I like to use the maps that one can often find on the internet, such as this very nice one by the Population Action International, that seeks to identify areas of high vulnerability. And there's many maps like this. You can find them on the internet very easily. But this particular map is very interesting because it tries to map where the countries are that experience the highly contentious, difficult, serious issues of high population growth and high decline in agricultural production, where there's also problems of resilience to climate change. And where are these places in the world? They're primarily in Africa, in the red zones of Nigeria, of Benin, of Ghana. They're also in the subcontinent of India, parts of Latin America as well. So by identifying the areas of greatest vulnerability, we can be quite sure that the poor are going to suffer the most from climate change. And our hypothesis is that land tenure and resource management issues are evolving very rapidly in these areas of high vulnerability. Let's take another example of a vulnerability index map. This one put out by Maplecroft is one that's used very widely in this field of study around climate change. The Climate Vulnerability Index identifies countries like Haiti, Bangladesh, Zimbabwe, Sierra Leone, Madagascar, and others that are extremely vulnerable to climate change for a number of variables and for a number of reasons. So from my perspective, it's very important to focus on what is happening in the tenure relations in these countries, because these countries are the ones that are and will suffer the most from climate change in the decades to come. So let's take an example of how vulnerability is unfolding at this time in various parts of the world, but around the issue of sea level projections. This is one of the cases that probably attracts the most attention from the general public and from each one of us. We know that the sea levels are rising, and rising much faster than was ever predicted. And why is that? It comes from a very simple physical reality. When water warms, it expands. When the global climate warms up, the oceans, of course, warm up. What happens when warming oceans occur? They begin to flood out coastal areas. And where does most of the world live? It's along the coasts of the world. It's around the United States. It's around Latin America, Asia, Africa. So looking at this graph is very frightening, because already global warming is having an impact on sea level rises. We see this through already flooding of lowland areas. We see this through storm surges, especially occurring during hurricanes and cyclones and typhoons. We see seawater intrusions throughout the world's coastal areas. And we don't need to search far. Look at the impact of Hurricane Katrina and the devastation that it played in the American coastal South. Look at the impact of Hurricane Sandy on the coastlines and the urban environments of New York City. Sea level projections are unfolding. They're a reality. And tenure situations are changing as a result. So think about it for a few minutes, of the regions vulnerable to sea level rise and how tenure systems may be evolving at this time. Look at the red points around South Florida, around New Orleans, around New York City, around Washington, D.C., and take a minute to think about the impacts that you have observed through your own general reading of newspapers and journals on what is happening to land value and settlement patterns and public policy. Think about the changes that are occurring around New York City as new zoning regulations are put in place to deal with the catastrophes that occurred during Hurricane Sandy. Think about what's happening to land values in North Carolina on the Outer Banks, where multi-million dollar homes are now resting on land that is nearly worthless from the perspective of insurance companies. But let's focus on a very vulnerable country like Bangladesh. Bangladesh is a case of a very low-lying country, very densely populated, 150 million people who live in highly vulnerable areas. Remember back to news reports of periodic cyclones and hurricanes that come through this part of the world, and the massive destruction that's been created as water flows from storm surges up into the deltas, flooding out millions of hectares of land, not only in Bangladesh, but in neighboring Myanmar. Think about the social costs as people leave flooded out, salted out rice fields and try to find other places to live. Now think a minute about what would happen if sea level rises increase by another 50 centimeters. How much land will be flooded out? And most importantly for our discussion today, where will those people move? Where will they find land? Where will they settle? What about the poorest people who generally live in the most vulnerable areas, which are areas that can be flooded very easily during heavy rainfall and are affected even more by cyclones? How will they find land? And what will the wealthy do with the assets that they have? Certainly, we know the answer. The wealthy will probably survive. They will be able to buy land of higher value, that is higher up away from flooding. And the poor, where will they go? They do not have many options. So the story of low-lying countries like Bangladesh and what is unfolding as we speak is a horrifying example of what may unfold in the decades to come. And the land tenure consequences of where people would settle, the land tenure consequences of changing markets for land are becoming apparent in low-lying countries of Bangladesh. And these are countries we ought to be studying very closely. But I'd like to move to an area of the world that I know very well, the Sahelian region of West Africa, and the country of Mali, Burkina Faso, Niger, and Chad, where I've worked over the years. And one of the issues that has interested me is the impact of climate change that I'm seeing right now, in which rainfall patterns are becoming more erratic, in which rainfall is declining over the years. I've seen it in my life. And what is happening to the landscape? We are beginning to observe the massive rush of rural people towards lowland depressions, where these depressions, these lowland, they call it in French, Mars, or these lowland bas-fonds, or these lowland floodplain areas are being captured by land elites and converted into dry season rice and horticultural production. Irrigated rice is expanding very rapidly in many parts of West Africa and certainly along the major river courses. And this capture of the land by those with assets is pushing off people. The gender implications are great. On the positive side, women who have assets are entering into horticultural production, both growing vegetables and marketing vegetables, and many are making a good penny. However, others, those who do not have financial assets, who cannot capture the land in these lowland depressions, are not able to manage their own lands. These people are becoming laborers for the wealthy, and often women who are the most asset poor are becoming day laborers in the rice and horticultural value chain. There's other vulnerable peoples in the West African Sahel, and the one that is dearest to me are the pastoralist transhumance populations who once herded their cattle, goats, and sheep throughout West Africa, following the rainfall patterns of the rainy season. Those pastoralist populations had long determined transhumance pathways where they could graze their cattle year by year, moving and following the seasonal flow of rainfall. These populations relied on lowland depressions and floodplains and swamps. Those places have been converted to rice production, to horticultural production. Those pastoralists can no longer find those pastures. They're the ones who are suffering, who are vulnerable, and in many cases who are fighting back the violence that we see unfolding in Mali, in Niger, in Chad, in northern Nigeria, can be in part ascribed to a struggle to assert rights over resources that are being lost as we speak. We're also seeing very profound changes in tree tenure And I've seen this in my life and in my study area of Northern Senegal, where I did my doctoral dissertation work. When I was there 30 years ago, the commons were very much in evidence. Trees had few property rights. But today, in many parts of the Sahel, trees that used to be open access trees are now encountering very highly articulated property rights regimes. Trees like the karité that produces shea butter are now privately owned. Open access resources have now become closed. Private property regimes around trees of high economic value in a changing climate have been emerging. In a country dear to me, Madagascar, where I used to live along the Fandrina-Vundruzu forest corridor, climate change is having an impact. In Madagascar, we're seeing that over the past 50 years, the temperature isohet has moved up the mountain slopes by 10 meters. That is, 50 years ago, it was much cooler, lower down in the valleys. Today, that situation is no longer there. In the shifting cultivation systems of Madagascar, this has enormous implications. Farmers who used to farm in the lowlands and would be stopped because farming was too cold higher up the mountain have now changed their farming patterns. As the environment warms, as the seasons become warmer, they are moving up the mountainside, and many of these mountainsides are national parks, and they're moving up and into national parks. As agriculture becomes more profitable and productive, because the growing season is warmer, farmers can move into areas that used to be environmentally off limits. We see this type of phenomena happening around the world with massive ecological implications, with massive social implications. For Madagascar, it's setting up for a major fight, a fight between the state that's trying to protect the boundaries of the National Park of Rana Mafan and the people who live in the buffer zones, who struggle for food security and see the forest as their last reserves of soil fertility that they need for the slash and burn agricultural system. Climate change is unfolding now. It's not a factor of the future.